Okay, so to end today, we're going to go over some brief kind of technical details about how to work with geographic data in R, mostly because geographic data is different from any of the data you've worked with before. So far, anytime you've worked with data, you've either loaded it as a CSV file, which is just a spreadsheet, or in the case of the World Bank data, we've been downloading that directly from the internet using the World Bank's website, and then it comes into R as a spreadsheet again. You have columns and you have rows, and that's your data. And it's easy to work with. You are all familiar with Excel. You're used to working with rows and columns, and spreadsheets are intuitive. Shape files are how we read geographic data. And they are different from CSV files or spreadsheets or anything that you've ever worked with. They do not look like regular CSV files. In fact, they're not even like a single file. When you download a shape file from the internet somewhere, it will generally pretty much always come as a zipped file that you then unzip, and then inside it'll have a whole bunch of different other files in it. Some of these aren't super important, like this is just a text file that says this is the version of the map, and if you open it, it has like one line in it and it says like 1.2 or something. This one has a README file. If you open that, it gives you instructions and kind of caveats to be concerned about with the data. But all these other files here, this PRJ, this DBF, this SHP, the SHX, those are all elements of geographic data that tell you where the different points are. If you have like boundaries of a country, it'll tell you all of the different contours of the boundaries. All of that lives in kind of the connection or the compilation between all of the compilation of all of these different files. So you technically need like all of them. So you download a shape file from somewhere, but it's really a whole bunch of shape files. And then when you load it into R, it will load all of the different pieces that you need. So the way this works is in R, easiest way to do this is there's a library called SF, which stands for simple features, because again, feature is a geographic term for just some element dealing with X and Y coordinates in space. And so if you load that library, you get a function called readSF, which will read simple features from a shape file. And so if you feed it the path to the shape file, notice how this path is really long. Like I made a data folder in this hypothetical example. Inside that data folder, I have this other folder, which has all the world boundaries in it from a website called Natural Earth, which provides free shape files for like the whole world, which is really cool. And so that Natural Earth folder has a whole bunch of stuff in it. So I'm reading the shape file that's in that Natural Earth shape file folder, which is in the data folder. And if it needs to pick up any of those other files like the SHX or the PRJ or whatever those other things are, it will do it because it knows that they're in that same folder as the shapefile. So you need to keep all of the different pieces of the shapefile together so that it can figure out what it needs when it loads. When you load it and we look at it, it's still spreadsheet-like. You still have columns, you still have rows. And the nice thing about using the SF package versus other packages is it forces it to act like a regular data frame. And so if you want to filter or summarize or group by or mutate or do any of the dplyr verbs that we've been doing, they work on these data sets that you load from a shapefile. So if we, like here we have country names, we have the ISO codes. And so if we want to just filter and choose like three different countries and plot those, we can say filter where ISO A3 is one of these three countries, or where the country name is one of these three countries. And it's just the regular filter syntax that you've been using. The only special thing that we have with these shape files is this column at the end, and it always places it at the end. Even if you mutate and add a new column, it will actually put it right before this magical geometry column. So this will always be at the very, very far end of your data. And if you look at it, it has this special type called multi-polygon, and that's because these are borders. And if you look here, these are just all of the different points that form the border of Fiji. So it starts at 180 degrees and down to negative 16 degrees for latitude and longitude, and then the next point moves up and the next point moves up. And so that whole chain of coordinates there are it's the border of Fiji. Some of these get really long, like Fiji's a small country, but if you go to Canada, this geometry cell right here is gonna be massive because it's including all of the little islands up in the north of of Canada up by the North Pole. It's including all of the little islands up by Newfoundland and over by Vancouver. So it's very, 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 very complicated. But all of that complicated geometry stuff lives inside a single cell in this column here. And that's the magical geometry column. You can do anything else you want with it. You can filter, you can group by, you can summarize. The only new thing after you load the shapefile is this geometry column. And that's the magical thing that makes it super easy to plot. Where do you find these shapefiles? The internet. So I already talked about Natural Earth. They have a country maps and world maps for the entire world. And you can download stuff there. It's all free, open source, public domain. You can do whatever you want with it. You can copy it. You can do whatever. It's free. Governments are generally responsible for providing their own shape files for any geographic stuff at any level. So if you want national shape files, if you want the shape files for each individual state in the United States, the census has those. Their job is to make shape files for things. So they have state-based shape files, they have regional shape files, they have zip code shape files, they have all sorts of things. If you click on that link, it'll take you to their page of all of the shape files they have. If you go to Google and search for US state shape files, you'll find it too. For anything else you want to find a shape file for, you just Google it. So if you want the shape files for Atlanta, the city of Atlanta should provide those, or the state of Georgia should provide those. They probably both do. And that's just kind of a standard government function nowadays at all levels. If you want county level shape files, most counties should provide those somewhere online. If they don't, their states should, and hopefully they do. In most cases they do. And so that's what you do. A couple of you in your first mini project decided you wanted to show a map of where all of the rats were in New York City. And so you emailed me and said, like, how do I get started? And I told you to just go to Google and search for New York City shapefile. And you all found different ones, and that's cool because the New York State provides their own, New York City provides their own. I think the individual boroughs will have their own specific shapefiles. That's kind of a public service that governments do nowadays, is they provide geographic data for free. So that's where you find this stuff, is you just Google. Some other things you need to pay attention to when you're downloading shapefiles is they work at different scales and different levels of detail. So for example, in Natural Earth, you have the possibility of downloading three different data sets for world shapefiles. You have this 10-meter version, the 50-meter version, and the 110-meter version. And what this means is like how detailed you get. So if you download this 10-meter version, that means that 1 centimeter on the map equals 100 kilometers in real life. And so it lets you get fairly close detail. If you look at this picture here, you can see kind of individual neighborhoods throughout New York City. That's how detailed you get. If you bump up to the 50-meter version, you notice that the boundaries for the different neighborhoods start getting less defined. If you look at the actual borders, you can see like this kind of barrier to, I think this is Long Island. I know nothing about New York. Whatever island this is, you can see this barrier here now. You can see very detailed coastlines. Once you start moving up the scale to the 1 to 50 meters, those coastlines get really flat because it's not trying to keep every single detail anymore. It's smoothing it out and making it less jagged. If you move up to the 110-meter version, that means 1 centimeter equals like 1,000 kilometers instead of 100 kilometers, and so the detail shrinks substantially now, and that's okay. If you try to map the entire world using the 10-meter version from Natural Earth, it will map, but it will take your computer a very long time to do it because it's going to draw every single little inlet on every island in the entire world and be as detailed as possible, and that's not great. If you want that to happen for like a specific state and you want to get as detailed as possible, cool, but don't do it for the whole world. So you want to choose the scale that's appropriate to what you're doing. Using too high of a resolution makes your map slow and huge and really hard to work with. The Census Bureau, they also offer different scales, and so you just have to pay attention when you look at the shapefiles. Make sure you get one that's the right level of detail, and the only way to figure that out is like plot it and see if it looks too jagged or if it looks too smooth, and figure out which one works the best. Another technical detail, you should print this picture and tape it on your wall and memorize it and always refer to it. In my office at GSU, I actually have this on my wall because I can never remember which is which with latitude and longitude. I can never remember which is X and which is Y. And this picture tells you latitude is Y, longitude is X. And people always think of like fun mnemonics to remember this. They'll say like longitude is long and so it's X. But that doesn't make sense because Y can also be long, and it's like that doesn't work for me. So I just really have this like ingrained in my head here, and I just have to remember that longitude is X and latitude is Y. That's important because if you're ever like working with the x-axis and the y-axis, you need to remember, like in your data, if you have a column that says latitude, you have to remember which one that is if it's X and Y. So I either refer to this, or recently, because I haven't been in my office, I just choose one, and if the map is sideways, then I chose the wrong one and I switched to the other one. And that's how I've been mapping recently, because I don't have a printed version of this. So memorize this. This will change your life, hopefully. So how to do this in R. So I already showed you how to load the shapefile in R using that readsf function. Once it's in R, as long as you have that magical geometry column, all you have to do is use this function called geomsf, which stands for geoms or simple features. And if you feed it the data set, it is smart enough to know what to do. And that's really all you have to do. You don't have to tell it to be a map. You just have to tell it to plot the simple features in that magic geometry column in our world shapes data set, and it will automatically plot all of these countries as countries. If the magic geometry column is just like the coordinates of specific cities, instead of being a multi-polygon with a whole bunch of borders around it, it'll just have two points. It'll have an X and a Y, or latitude and longitude, or longitude and latitude, because X is longitude. It'll have just those two points. And so when you say geomsf, it's gonna look at that column and notice that there's just two points, and it'll say, that's a point, not a border, and it'll put the things on the map as dots instead of trying to draw shapes. It's really smart. It figures out what you want to plot. If you have lines, like a path, like a freeway or something, it will recognize that and know that it's not an area. It will know that it's not a point, and it'll draw a line instead. It's super smart. And that's really all you do. Those two lines of code, ggplot plus geomsf, makes that map. That easy. And because it's regular ggplot stuff, you can add other layers to there. If you want to change the labels, if you want to change the theme, it's just like everything else we've used. You can change the coordinates really easily. So if we want to make this a Mercator map, all we have to do is tell it to use this chord SF, and then we say CRS, which means coordinate reference system, and we put in this magic incantation that I got from the internet, from those different websites that show a list of all of the different projections, and it will automatically transform all of the numbers in that magic geometry column into whatever they need to be to plot as Mercator. If we want the Robinson projection, just change the CRS to projection equals Robinson, and there's our Robinson map, just like that. All of the other aesthetics work like normal. So if we want to map population onto each of the countries here and fill by population, we can. So here's our fun gradient here with basically the entire world is very, very dark blue except for India and China because they have massive populations. And so the scale here ranges from 0 to 1 billion, but most countries are down here. So that's not the most helpful map. But it does show that like this is how you do it with R, like regular ggplot stuff. We're saying fill by population. That's one of the columns that is in the natural earth data. Color by white, or color with white, so all the borders are white. Size by 0.15, so they're very, very thin borders. If we sized it by like 2, all of these border lines would be really, really thick. We're using the Robinson projection. We're using gradient fill. We took off the labels. We used theme void to get rid of all of the grid lines behind because we don't want like those white curvy lines. And we got rid of the labels because we don't need to know that this is 120 degrees west and 60 degrees west. It's a map, it looks like that. And so, and then finally we move the theme down to the bottom, or move the legend down to the bottom. And that's kind of a standard how we work with ggplot workflow. The only difference is we're using geomsf instead of geomcol or geomline or anything like that. If you have a data set that does not have that magic geometry column, for instance, here's two cities here. There's a very, very tiny data set that I called other data. It's just two cities with their longitude and their latitude points. So that is X and Y, I hope. That is not the magic geometry column. If we try to feed this into GeomSF, it won't know what to do. It'll give up because it just sees those as numbers. So what we have to do is somehow make this long lat thing turn into that magic geometry column, even though this isn't a shapefile. This is just a regular CSV that we got from the internet somewhere, or hand typed in this case. And the way you do that is there's a function called st_as_sf. And if you tell that function which column is latitude and which column is longitude, it will make the magic geometry column for you. So it'll look like this. So here we're saying st_as_sf. The coordinates are long and lat. So it needs to know X and it needs to know Y. And then the final argument we have to give is this CRS. We have to tell it what coordinates reference system these points are actually using right now. And so this 4326, that's just one that I have memorized and I've copied and pasted from other things. That's the coordinate reference system that Google Maps uses. And so it's just saying that this came from Google Maps or from that projection that Google Maps uses. And so then convert it to geometry. And so if you look at the data now, we have a column for city. We lost our longitude and latitude columns. Those disappeared because it combined into this magic geometry column, which is just points. And so now if we stuck this into GeomSF, it would draw 2 points on the map. If we just stuck it into GeomSF by itself, all we would see is 2 points. We wouldn't actually see any state borders or anything. Because we're not plotting any state borders, we're just plotting points. So if you want state borders, you have to plot kind of the state shapes shapefile, and so you get all the borders. If you want rivers and lakes, you can plot another layer of shapefiles on top of that. And then if you want these points, you can plot that on top, and it'll add all of the points on top of the lakes and the rivers on top of the boundaries. And so you're just layering a whole bunch of different geographic things onto your plot. And you'll get experience with that in the example and in the exercise for today, how you layer these different shape files onto a thing. Finally, this SF package is fairly new. It's only been released for the past like 3-ish years. You can do all sorts of GIS stuff with it, this geographic information things. You can draw maps. That's what we've been doing here. You can also calculate distances between points. You can figure out how you want to calculate those distances. If you want to follow like a great circle route that follows the curvature of the earth, or if you want like as the crow flies route, there's a whole bunch of different ways of calculating distance. You can count the observations in a given area. So you can like take a city and say, draw a 30-mile radius around the city and then figure out how many rat sightings there were in that area or something. You can do all sorts of like grouping and summarizing type stuff with geographic information using this SF package. Basically, anything related to geography, you can do with SF. And it's a really complicated, powerful package. There's actually 2 textbooks out there that people are writing for how to use SF for all sorts of GIS stuff. If you're interested, you can click on those links and see them. They're really neat. The final thing I need to warn you about is when you're Googling for how to draw a map in ggplot, before the SF package was invented and it was so easy because you have that magic geometry column that just magically figures out how to plot, it was a lot more complicated to read in shape files and determine what are boundaries and what are points and what are lines and all of that stuff. And so there used to be, I think it's still in ggplot, but it's rarely used, called geommap. And that will plot a map, but you don't want to use that here because that's kind of the older way of doing it. It doesn't work with that magical geometry column that magically comes in when you load a shapefile. There's also a package called ggmap that you might come across that has its uses. It hasn't been updated for a while. Ggmap was originally invented to make it a little bit easier to draw maps of ggplot prior to this SF magical stuff. It also lets you plot maps from Google Maps directly using their API, and you have to create an account with Google Maps to let you do that. Google Maps has been limiting access to that and making it so that you can't get as many requests per day. And so it's not the greatest way of showing maps anymore. The SF package really is. And so if you're Googling stuff and you find an answer on Stack Overflow and it says use Geom Map to plot this thing, it's not going to work if you're working with this SF stuff. And so if you're going to Google like how to draw a map in ggplot, make sure you include SF in your search so that it knows to look for the more modern SF-based stuff. Because that's really the easiest way. Like if you want to change the projection, it really is just like S or quad SF, and suddenly you have all the same projections or whatever projection you want. And it's like ridiculously easy to do. So in general, stick with the SF package and this Geom SF thing, and your life will be a lot easier than trying to figure out the older ways of doing this and manually reading in shapefiles and stuff. This really is kind of like the standard way of doing mapping stuff nowadays, because it is really easy. It's just add Geom SF and you're done. So there will be an example of this that you can head over to and watch and follow along if you want. And there's a short exercise where you basically just make a map and add stuff to the map. And it should be fun. So good luck with that.